How's it going, folks? It's Tuesday, September 24th. This is locally sourced episode 6. Take a second to hop down in the description. You can find our Patreon, support us, hit the subscribe button. If you hit the little bell, you'll get notifications. So when we do things like these live streams, you'll get notified about it. Yeah, so here we are. Gonna try out some new formatting stuff this evening. And one of those things that I'm gonna try is to just give you guys some basic headlines. So let's see here. After the climate strike on Friday, Greta Thunberg and 15 other kids announced they're suing 5 of the world's major carbon polluters on grounds that the countries are violating their rights as children, which would turn this into a children's rights crisis, not just a climate crisis. So you're kind of expanding the scope of everything. So that's some hard action being taken, not just protesting. New Hampshire carbon pricing bill, HB 735, is going back into legislative committee. This is something that if you listen to the most recent episode of the weekly news roundup on NHPR, they talk about this, how basically a lot of the bills that we've seen get vetoed are going to come back around and end up being voted on all over again just over the course of the next year. So this is one, it's going back in a committee. They're going to look at it a good deal more. See, it would put roughly $20 per ton price on carbon emissions for businesses that use or import fossil fuels. It would increase annually. Proceeds go mostly to rebated customers. You can go check it out after the stream. I'll have links in the bottom so you can read more about it. And I'll put the link to the actual bill, so if you want to get weedy about it, you can. And see here, the representative who spoke on it quoted saying, economists tell us this is the single most effective measure we can take to combat the climate crisis, to transition to clean energy, which she goes on to acknowledge is a marginal, eating around the edges of the problem type of proposal. And I think we can all acknowledge that that's not even kind of enough to deal with the problem. So as great as that is, let's, you know, keep it moving. Moving on from there, New Hampshire DOJ and DMV are having a hard time explaining the new voting laws regarding voter registration. So, and I actually have a map that I wanted to pop over to and show everybody because it's a bit comical. So, yeah, so here's the map that they are referring to. And basically what you're seeing here is town by town, the darker the green, the more out of state voter registration that's happening. And when you zoom in, it becomes fairly clear right off the bat that the darkest areas are college towns. So we know exactly who this is meant to affect. And if you look at the way college students vote predominantly, they tend to vote more liberally than conservative. Not all, but many. Either way, it just seems like a really bad call to be alienating all those students. So at any rate, that's fun. And you know, like, there's a lot of really great reporting that you can check out from NHPR, where they sort of go into saying, you know, the agency refused to say whether they've enacted any new policies or procedures as of the new residency laws, whether there are plans to collect information from voter records as result of the change. Plans to collect information from voter registration records as a result of the change. And more generally, what steps the agency will take to enforce new law. So it's just, you know, everything's super vague. And meanwhile, we got to deal with that running up into primaries, which are going to happen in February. So it's not actually that far out when you really think about it. And yeah, bad news bears. The state has declined proposed mediation in the Conval funding case. So if you've been following that in the Ledger transcript, you know that the court ruled in favor of the Conval school districts when they appealed I think it was like an appeal of appeal. I'll have to go back and do more reporting on it for you guys or dig into it a little better, because this is not enough right now. But essentially, where we're at currently is the attorney for Conval had wanted to engage in some sort of mediation to try and come to a resolution over the funding, because it's unconstitutional, the mandate, and we can't afford it as taxpayers. So, you know, it's an untenable situation, and the state came back refusing to engage in any kind of mediation process, which is just, like, ridiculous. They have until, I think, Thursday to agree to it. So there's still time. They could still get down with it. But, yeah, they have already sort of come straight out and said, no, we're not going to do that. So that's really annoying. The attorneys said, you know, the attorneys for Conval said that they would always sit down. The DOJ comms director basically said in an email that no comment. It's pending before the court, so no comment. Great. Okay. Cool. New research from the University of New Hampshire shows wilderness therapy is more effective and cheaper than traditional methods for treating adolescents with substance use and mental health issues. That's straight off NPR today, NHPR today. I'll put the link directly to their article as well as the report itself that goes into this. There have been some pieces that have come out over the past few months, but it's not something that's widely talked about, and we have programs like that here in the state. So it's worth communities investing and acknowledging in that kind of stuff more, because it's good for our communities. It's a cheaper and better way to help get people out of addiction that are trying to get out of addiction. So, moving on to some just straight local stuff. Peterborough Players have Arts on Screen coming up. It opens on October 5th. You can go check out shows from the Met Opera, National Theatre of London, as well as their screenings of The Flight of the Fantastic, 42nd Street, and Kinky Boots. You can go over their website and get more information on that if that's something that, you know, sparks your interest. As far as local events, on the 25th, so tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. in the Peterborough Townhouse, there's going to be the Arts Alive Arts Collective meeting to basically talk about where we go from here with the closure of Sharon Arts. So if local arts matter to you, please attend tomorrow. It would be super super appreciated. Let's see here. There's going to be a Small Business Association award and celebration for Max Makerspace, which is where we're broadcasting from right now. They received $100,000 through the Match Pilot Competition Program through the Small Business Association, specifically in regard to the welding program they got going here. So if you want to come over and learn some more about that, you can do that tomorrow from 10:30 to 11 in the morning. So, you know, it's a little tight, a little short notice, but if you can make it and you want to learn more about it, it's here. Politic wise, you can go catch Elizabeth Warren and Keene on the tomorrow as well. She's going to be there from, it looks like, 4 to 7:30 p.m. at 48 Madison Street, so I'll try and get links for that as well. Andrew Yang's going to be at Post and Beam on Thursday. I'm going to be there trying to get footage, maybe asking some questions. We'll talk a little bit more about that this evening. Let's see, there's, you know, as far as music goes, you've got Dub Hub open mic night on Friday at 7. There's the 4th annual concert and stargazing at the Cathedral of Pines in Ringe on Friday at 7. And, you know, if you want to catch something a little later, you can go to the Upchuck Creek Live at Harlow's on Friday. Peterborough Community Theater's got Peanut Butter Falcon Wednesday and Thursday. Then The Art of Racing in the Rain starts Friday. They also just introduced house-made natural popcorn toppings, sweet and salty. Flavors including gingerbread, Mexican chocolate, Dorito ranch, and several others. Check out their website for more. That's a nice little feature. And I think I could get down with that. You know, it's another reason to go to the local theater. Let's see, as far as I was told about an event on Saturday, 28th, No Coal, No Gas, it's organized by Nonviolent Citizen Action. People are risking arrest at this event to rally against the Bow Coal Plant, which doesn't have an established closure date. So if you want to go show solidarity for that, you can head out to Bow from 11 to 3 p.m. You know, if you feel like you haven't gotten enough climate activism in the past week, you want to keep it going, a good next spot to check out. So and I was told by the Ledger transcript that they're going to have a, let's see, arts as an industry focused business quarterly coming up on October 8th. So that's definitely getting a bit more attention to arts in the community. Glad to see that happening. I'm hoping to have Ben on at some point soon, just talk about what it's like to be the editor of a local paper. And maybe just try and get some of that perspective, because I think we might all be able to get less frustrated or doubt things less when we can have a better understanding of what it's like to be on the other side of the fence. So that's an interview that I'd really like to have coming up, and, you know, pretty excited about it. Generally speaking, you may have been able to tell by all the things that I just listed off, but we're gonna mostly focus here on arts, environment, politics from a local perspective as much as possible, but not totally limited to. So if you have any events or anything like that that aren't related to any of the main things that I cover, but you want to share it here, please get in touch. I'd love to just, I just want to let people know what's going on in the area. You know, make sure that when people have new things come out, we can get everybody up to date on it. I don't know how common knowledge it was that the theater got flavored new flavors for their popcorn, but that's something that I care about, and I was pretty excited to talk about it. So at any rate, I noticed they're going to be getting It Chapter 2. They had said it was their first horror movie that they're picking up since the new owners have taken over, so that's pretty exciting, and I was looking forward to checking that out, so now I know I can. Moving on from that, I mentioned at the top Andrew Yang's going to be here on Thursday, and Andrew has referred to himself as a futurist. And I think it's important that we maybe talk about that word a little bit. Because I think people use it in a way that they don't fully understand the history behind the word and the term and the movement. So I wanted to take a little bit of time this evening and actually kind of go into what is the futurist movement, what does it stand for, what does it represent, and I want to kind of bounce that back over in relation to Yang. So let's see here. The Futurist Manifesto, which was written by, I just want to make sure I get his name correct here, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, I'm just going to pull up the manifesto right here. I've actually got a copy of it. And I just want to sort of show the text. Futurism as a movement, this is from the Wikipedia, and I'll actually try and pull that up right now just so that we can sort of have it in front of us while we, you know, don't always trust everything on Wikipedia, obviously. I would never rely on it as a decent source, but I will get a baseline here, so. Okay. So, here's the wiki for it, and just reading straight off the screen here. Artistic and social movement that originated in Italy in the early 20th century emphasized speed, technology, youth, violence, and objects such as the car, airplane, and the industrial city. So I just kind of want to take a moment to point out that the word violence is in there. Okay? And to depart from that, because I don't want to stick to that too much, I want to give you folks the real deal here. I have actually a copy of this, and I'm just going to pop that up here. So here we go. This is the Futurist Manifesto as it was originally written. And essentially this, you know, as a movement, it really seeks, it's the whole tear it all down idea in a lot of ways. And these guys viewed the Industrial Revolution, particularly in Italy, where it started. Although there's certainly other strains of it in different countries, but it's very prominent in Italy, and is often referred to as an Italian movement. You know, this is at a time where Europe is being heavily industrialized, and there's this growing sense of nationalism. It's not long till Mussolini's in. And, you know, it's in a lot of ways they wanted to reach into a certain power of like, hey, destroy the system. So it's coming from a place that I think a lot of people can truly understand, but it, as you can see here, I mean, I'll just, you know, I'll pull up some of these quotes here from the actual thing here. So it's, you know, we wish to glorify war, the only health giver of the world, militarism, patriotism, the destructive arm of the anarchist, the beautiful ideas that will kill, the contempt for woman. Look, that's the only time. This is the only time that the word woman shows up in this document. And it is preceded by the phrase, the contempt for. Okay, so we're already looking at an inherently sexist document. In the line directly below that, they say they wish to destroy the museum, the libraries, to fight against moralism, feminism, and all the opportunistic and utilitarian meannesses. So, I mean, for me, when I read this right now, when I look at this document and this language today, it reads like a really angry post on 4chan. Maybe that's just my perception of it, but if anybody has spent any amount of time on there or even been on Reddit and just looked at all for 20 minutes, you'd see posts on there from it at some point. It's this kind of like this edgy thing. And it's encased in this notion of hardness and it in many ways precedes things like brutalism could be a form of futurist movement and sort of like it or take influence from it by the same stretch. Surrealism, Dada, all that kind of stuff really incorporated some of the more of the handful of positive takeaways from futurism as an artistic movement for literature and painting and photography, any architecture, any of those positive takeaways in the art world oftentimes were sort of consumed and repurposed and recontextualized through other movements that arguably did it better. And historically, in art, at least as my understanding of it in a contemporary sense, it's like futurism is it's a way to get to a certain point, but not necessarily a total foundation. Although I think it's probably coming back because we now have a whole, you know, it's the internet has like provided the new Industrial Revolution type of spark that would reignite a futurist vision. So at any rate, to just sort of finish up on like a history point, you know, the guy who wrote the Futurist Manifesto, Marinetti, he ended up going on to work on writing the fascist manifesto for Mussolini. And, you know, his futurist political party that he founded ultimately was consumed by see if I have it here. Yeah, it just ended up being merged with Mussolini's Italian Fasci of Combat, which is, you know, that's, you're talking militia. And I think it's, yeah, there is absolutely a lot of very interesting art that came from that movement, and it certainly spawned a lot of really great things in terms of what we see, what we can consume, and it's definitely thrown ideas out into the world that we have to challenge in a lot of ways. I'm grateful that, you know, we're able to look at this document right here. I really am, because, you know, this offers us a chance to challenge this idea, and that's not something that we should ever scoff at or reject. I mean, it's, you gotta go against it when you can. So, I'm just gonna put this clip of Andrew Yang up really quick.
Blown away by the fact that everyone in America thought this was a good idea in the 60s and 70s, and now it takes the far out futurist Asian man to make the case. He's like, what the heck happened in those 50 years? And
so, there was, there was an opinion piece published on the Gotham Gazette by a woman named Kimberly Watkins. This was published on the 20th, so this came out Friday. This was recent. Okay. I'm going to pull this up so that I can show you guys this quote, because it's just, it's really, it's a challenge for me. It's a tough thing to read, but I do just kind of want to get to this one point here. She says, on the third day that she was back from work after her honeymoon in 2007, Yang fired her. Yang's remarks were that because she was married, she wouldn't want to continue as working as hard as she had been, that as a wife, she'd be focused on her new life. She acknowledges how she didn't even realize how unethical this was. But just, you know, when I see something like that, and then, you know, I go back and look at this, he's showing you exactly what he believes here. It's, you know, for me, this is a, you know, I'm going to believe in what you do and not in what you say for now. And this is not a good look for Yang. But Kimberly goes on to explain that her severance package, like her compensation, you know, which was off the books. He basically just sort of like bought her out, and you know, it was like payout over, what was it, for 2 years right here. So, you know, he's paying her off for a certain period of time for the work that she did, but he's replaced her. And her point here is, this sounds a whole lot, whole hell of a lot like the freedom dividend. You know? Why would getting married suddenly make you not want to do the thing that you're passionate about? Didn't happen to me. So, given that he is going to be in this town, if you're watching this stream, please go to Post and Beam and bring this up. Make him reckon with this. I want to... this is something that has to be addressed. You know, and if you go and post anything like this on the internet, like, that Yang Gang will come straight after you, okay? And I have friends that work on this campaign, all right? Like, and they're good people, but I just can't with this particular situation, all right? This is too much. I don't care how good of a policy the freedom dividend is. I don't care, you know, $1,000, bro. Sorry. Doesn't undo the dog whistle to fascists that is calling yourself a futurist. All right, so I'm going to move on now. This next bit, this piece is something that I have been trying to work on for a while now. Give a little bit more framing around what's going on between the Attorney General and the Hillsborough County Attorney. So, I think the most, I guess, in a prudent way, the way I'll probably deal with this is I'm gonna show the weekly roundup videos from NHPR, because they've been broadcasting them on Facebook lately, which is super convenient. I'll cut into it a little bit, and we won't watch all of it, and I'll hop between episodes. And then I also want to sort of show some other articles that will provide a bit broader of a view. So I'm just gonna switch over to this now.
County Attorney Michael Conlon might be in. The Attorney General's office says it's exploring what steps to take against Conlon. So we want to spend some time getting the two conflicting sides of this dispute. So to start, Mark, why is the Attorney General's office so unhappy with Michael Conlon?
It's the latest The latest problem was a plea bargain that was entered last Friday regarding two parents whose toddler died of a drug overdose. There was they were drug dealers. There was large amounts of drugs and cash in their apartment, and their 20-month-year-old son, Peyton Garvey, died of a cocaine overdose because he just crawled around and got exposed to the drugs. The plea bargain called for a sentence that even the judge thought was lenient. The father pleaded guilty to negligent homicide. He has to do 5 years behind bars, 2 years of drug treatment, and if he passes the drug treatment, he's out of prison. If he doesn't.
So, just briefly, this is they're talking about the case that sort of really set everything off, and in the next episode of the news roundup, they actually have Conlon on. So switch over that.
Open house September 14th. Registration at unh.edu. And merchants sought.
All right, so just want to get this queued up here. All righty, here we go.
So now that the AG has taken control over criminal cases, what's your role at the office?
My role.
Okay, so just to sort of catch up here. So basically, because of the way these cases were handled, there was a huge outcry from police chiefs. Chief Capano from Manchester called the ruling on that case disgusting. Now, because the AG AG basically used this and a couple other cases to suggest that Conlon is just not doing his job. That's a fair thing to get upset about on the out front. Okay, we're looking at, incredibly lenient, like a judge thinks it's lenient ruling for a couple parents whose kid died of a cocaine overdose. It's pretty bad. All right. Well, let's, I'm gonna listen to Conlon a little bit here. And just sort of hear what he has to say about that.
Role continues as the elected Hillsborough County Attorney. There are a lot of issues at this.
The AG's office did sort of, they've stepped in and basically said they're going to take over control of his office. And they wanted former police chief David Mara to basically oversee his work and babysit him.
Office, I would say, both regarding the administration of the office.
Open house September. Sorry about that, folks. I'm still trying to get all of the hotkeys for this show set up, so every once in a while I'll have a weird bump in the cutting. So at any rate, until I get it figured out, sorry about it.
And I look forward to continuing those efforts to the extent that the Attorney General allows me. I would also be willing to help out in any way possible with the prosecutorial operations of the office. There's a lot of issues across the board here.
So right now, are you just solely in control of civil cases, not criminal cases?
Well, the office doesn't actually handle civil cases the same way that the Attorney General's office does. Our function is largely. Open house September. Any way possible with the prosecutorial operations of the office. You know, there's a lot of issues across the board here.
So right now, are you just solely in control of civil cases, not criminal cases?
Well, the office doesn't actually handle civil cases the same way that the Attorney General's office does. Our function is largely related to the prosecution of felonies and misdemeanor appeals in the county. But I'm here to do a large component of the rest of the work, which is having strong relationships with other agencies the office works with, the day-to-day functionality of the office, personnel, budget, and other matters.
Okay. And you've said you inherited many of the problems that the AG is concerned about. And they acknowledge this, that some were very longstanding, but they say you had ample time and guidance from them to make changes.
Okay. I just want to take a moment to say here that this is what it comes down to right here. This is sort of the thing that we really need to pay attention to here is how big is the task that is untangling the mess of the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office, and B, what was the situation that preceded this? So in a minute here, I've got information on the attorney who Conlon replaced, Dennis Hogan, and just a little bit of what's up with that guy. But I'm going to keep this rolling for a minute. So
here's Deputy Attorney General Jane Young on Wednesday.
There has to be policies and procedures, communications with police departments, communications with victims. And that comes from one person, the county attorney.
So, Attorney Conlon, what's your response? Have you implemented some of the policies and procedures they recommended?
Well, the first recommendation for any specific policies and procedures came to me at the end of July when I had just finished the four-month process of dealing with our budget, which both as a result of their review from this office last year, was underscored as an incredibly important priority of this office. And when I came here in January.
So I just want to point. Okay, so what he's saying here is that when he got to the office, everybody was like, the budget's the most important thing that we have to deal with. So he then sunk the next 4 months into just trying to sort out the budget problems, which sounds like it was a huge bear. And he. You know, he's claiming that he didn't hear anything until July. So
I did my best to insert myself into the day-to-day operations and understand what was going on. And I would say that, you know, the notion that the situation is dire today, it was even more dire in January when I first started here. I took the time to invest in the top priority of the budget that the team also agreed with me was the top priority of the office to get the resources that haven't been received over the past decade by the county budget process. As I worked with my management team to free them up as best as I could with the resources I had available, and then explore what policy procedures would be a priority based on my discussions with them, since the Attorney General's review in calendar 2018 under prior administration had no specific guidance as to what policy and procedures should be made, nor any prioritization as to areas of focus.
And so there were some procedures that.
So, okay, basically, Conlon's saying right now that he didn't get any actual guidance, and that with the preceding county attorney, there was nothing established in record about, oh, this is how you're supposed to deal with things, or this is what we think you should be doing. So under Dennis Hogan, who had been the prior county attorney, none of these suggestions had been established. That's essentially what Conlon's saying. So that begs the question, well, how can you make changes if you don't understand what those changes are? And already, if you've been following this, you understand that this right now looks like very much so like a sort of he said, they said type of situation. And it's not It's hard to say, you know, who's going to be the more reliable in this situation without us, you know, having records of every conversation. And, you know, and for his part in this interview, Conlon talks about how he's, you know, is absolutely, in, used, to use his word, incensed about what happened with the that child overdose case. You know, it's kind of nitpicky to ask somebody to be know exactly what everybody's doing all the time. We do have limits as human beings, and I know that Conlon's whole MO was to come in and be a problem solver, but there's a limit to what people can do, especially when they spend a decent amount of time just fighting to get a budget, which he got. And he has gone on to hire new staff members. As he points out in this interview, his office saw over 3,000 cases in 2018. So, yeah, and he's, and they're on track to do those same numbers this year, which is just, that's insane. That's a crazy number of cases to have to deal with. On top of fixing your budget with a, what is notoriously a rough office, and they've had a lot of communication problems. And a lot of the articles that I see talk about it from the police are upset about this because they feel like they're not being heard. And when it comes to Capano and that whole situation, you know, he's calling out very specific numbers. You know, he's saying, oh, I want this guy to get at least 10 years. Like, I'm sorry, man. I respect experience, but, and I'm not even advocating for a light sentence for this particular case with this child overdose, but if you don't take stuff into account fully, you know, we're just over punishing people. We already do enough of that in this country. Okay. And for the most part, anyone knows that, when it comes to solving, like, particularly a drug problem, it's way more advantageous to treat it like a medical issue than a crime. So, you know, if you nurture folks and try and give them outlets and opportunities and more chances to just get it together, and you show them love, that's far more effective in reducing drug use or crime or anything like that. So, you know, that type of thing makes me wary. When you're like, and I say it in the sense that there's a line across, like, if your municipality is a certain size, then it becomes like, okay, we need to have this type of thing handed off to somebody higher, because maybe we can't see beyond our immediate area, or maybe there's just too many people involved, there's way too much chance. And then on the flip side, it's like, hey, if you live in a town that's got like 3,000 people in it, like, I don't see why, you know, you can't have police prosecutors handling cases. Like, that's okay. And Conlon even acknowledges throughout, he says he doesn't think that there's anything that, like, in separate articles that can be found, he talks about how he didn't he didn't not trust local attorneys to deal with something. He just wanted to make sure that his office was taking responsibility for the cases that they're supposed to take responsibility for. So at any rate, so I'm going to hop to the third clip from this, the most recent of them. Excuse the audio's just hopping in. Just trying to get the time lined up here. This last one is a bit shorter. Okay, folks, here we go.
So Matt, this week the Executive Council turned down the nomination of David Mara as Assistant Attorney General, which was a necessary step in bringing him into the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office.
Okay, so just let me... I need to get the correct screen up here. Okay, so basically, I'm going to show this clip. Now, this past week, there was an Executive Council meeting, and they went over a whole bunch of stuff. And there's actually a video that you can check out from us about the climate advocates outside of the townhouse that morning, at any rate. At this Executive Council meeting, there was a really, really contentious exchange, which I can go back and I'll play that as well, because there's some clips from that in a different piece featuring some of the people from NHPR. So, basically, there were two no votes, two yay votes, and an abstention from the Executive Council. There's, if you don't know the Executive Councilor, what that is, it's a really important part of our state government, which I could go into at a later date, but I'm not going to dig into it now. But there are five Executive Councilors. Our governor used to be one, just frame of reference. And so because it was essentially a draw, David Mara, the recommended sort of overseer of Conlin by the Attorney General, was denied. And so in this roundup, they're talking about that a little bit. And so that's the jump off point. And they've got Matt Sartwell from the union leaders. Here we go.
To provide some oversight. Why did the Executive Council vote the way it did?
Well, I mean, you got to kind of go back and lay the what happened here. So Hillsborough County Attorney Michael Conlin was swept into the office in the blue wave. He defeated Dennis Hogan, a Republican. Almost immediately in March, there were calls to the AG's office to take over criminal prosecutions from Conlin. Then this month, Gordon...
Okay, just... I want to take note of that. Almost immediately there were calls. Okay, I just sort of want to point out that when you have that changeover, that has a pretty partisan smell to it. Let's keep going.
Gordon McDonald steps in after a plea deal in the case of 20-year-old Tayden Garvey.
For this story, let's turn to Matt Sartwell.
Here. So Hillsborough County Attorney Michael Conlin was swept into the office in the blue wave. He defeated Dennis Hogan, a Republican. Almost immediately in March, there were calls to the AG's office to take over criminal prosecutions from Conlin. Then this month, Gordon McDonald steps in after a plea deal in the case of 20-year-old Tayden Garvey of Manchester, because the plea deal was deemed too lenient by some. Tayden died, sadly, from ingesting cocaine from one of his parents' drug stashes back in 2018. So, and the loudest voice against the plea was probably Manchester Police Chief Carlo Capano. He called the deal disgusting. So then that brings us up to date, where Gordon McDonald's plan was to put former Manchester Police Chief David Mara in charge of the prosecutions. Mara, as you all know, is currently the state's drug czar. So Democrats on the council deemed the move to put Mara in charge of the criminal prosecutions for the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office too strong and rejected it. So that kind of leaves us with some critics calling the vote asinine, and that Democrats on the council are putting politics before public safety. And then on the other side, counselors and some lawyers saying the AG's play was just way, way too strong and it was overkill.
I just want to pull that back and just make sure that I'm getting the words right here.
The plea deal was deemed too lenient by some.
Okay.
Tatum died public safety. And then on the other side, you have counselors and some lawyers in charge of the criminal prosecutions for the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office too strong and rejected it. So that kind of leaves us with some critics calling the vote asinine, and that Democrats on the council are putting politics before public safety.
Okay. This is what I want to stop on right here. So just Democrats are the ones putting politics ahead of things. Democrats are the ones putting politics ahead of things. Okay. So let's go and check out if that's true or not. Okay. So I am going to switch back over to this particular bit right here. And we're going to listen to this, and I'm just going to sort of.
This is All Things Considered on NHPR. I'm Peter Biello. Leadership of the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office is in flux today, asking David Mara, currently the state's...
...the reins over criminal cases in the Hillsborough County Attorney's Office, implement some of the policies and procedures we've been recommending, and that person needs to be David Mara. And here he is making that case.
I am before this council asking for the resource to do that. That's the question before the council. And if you vote no, I am telling you, that will compromise our ability to protect the people of our state.
But Gordon MacDonald did not get what he wanted. David Mara was not confirmed.
I want to point out, if you go back and listen to that again, you can hear him tapping the desk or like pounding his fist, like he's getting really upset. And it's funny to hear him get a little bit fired up there. So I just want to hop over.
Well, some members of the executive council took issue with the way that the AG was going about this. They basically said by stripping County Attorney Michael Conlon of so many of his responsibilities, you're essentially taking away the power of an elected official, and that's a big deal. Councillor Andrew Walensky, a Democrat, proposed that the AG's office essentially get a mediator to iron out some kind of power-sharing agreement between them and County Attorney Michael Conlon. Here he is basically asking Attorney General Gordon MacDonald whether he would consider that.
Are you saying you won't agree to a mediative process in order to protect the people of this state? Because you'll get my vote if you agree to do that.
We have tried to engage this county attorney constructively and collaboratively.
You won't be surprised if I've heard different things from the county attorney, which suggests to me that you two are talking past each other.
So it was a test.
All right. You can go check out the rest of that on their website. That's a free article. It's not, you can go just check it out and listen more. But let's be mindful here that Andrew Walensky is basically saying, hey, can you guys get a mediator? And MacDonald's like, nah. You know, it's sort of, you know, when he says we've tried to engage this county attorney constructively and collaboratively, like that's the definition of a non-answer. And is essentially saying, no, I'm not willing to do any. I mean, he could easily just directly answer that question with a yes or a no, but chooses to give Walensky neither. I mean, just pull it back up on the screen. You know, that's the transcript right there. Like, come on, man. So this is, that's like, that is a classic political dodge. Okay. That's absolutely a classic political dodge. And so the person doing that dodge right there, not being proper and direct, is McDonald, not Walensky. So that's looks like a partisan move. And what's more important to note is that an attorney general is appointed, and the county attorney is elected. And there's a really, we as citizens and voters need to put some stock in that right there. And acknowledge that, you know, if we voted for somebody, that's who we want there. And I don't think it would be too far off to say it's a bit of a power grab. To essentially force out a county attorney before he even had a chance to finish his first year. I mean, and as we said earlier, he was getting called out as early as March. You know, he only started in January. He's just like less than 3 full months. So that's just, you know, you're already giving this really sort of like partisan look, right? Now, related to McDonald, okay, if you go to the Wikipedia for Gordon McDonald, right? So here, this article links out, okay? This is an article that's directly referenced. And this is from the union leader, so we trust this, right? At least for what it is. Now, I think what's important to point out here is what Gatzes says about this, saying that Gordon McDonald was nominated to be the Chief Justice, so the top judge in the state, and he was denied by the Executive Council. For anybody that missed that, he was denied by the Executive Council a seat to be the Chief Justice for the state, so top judge. And you've got people basically saying, you know, like, well, we don't understand. We don't understand why he wouldn't get confirmed. I mean, he's, you know, as Gatzes says here, he never thought McDonald would give him a partisan answer on anything. You know, he's saying even the most partisan people are behind this nominee. As I think, you know, we got that up here. And I got to tell you, Ted Gatzes, this right here, this is exactly why you don't confirm Gordon McDonald, because he is super partisan. If you want to, like, splay this out, okay, and really assess this, any accusation that the Democrats on the Executive Council are acting in a partisan way is essentially a projection. Because you know, so far as I can tell, I mean, you know, if Andrew Walensky was really to act in a partisan way, he wouldn't be offering to, you know, suggesting, hey, can we have a mediated thing here? Like, can you guys work it out? Can you come up with a power sharing agreement, something, anything? So just that outright rejection is kind of a huge red flag in terms of, like, who's being partisan in that conversation, who's not. And I'm sure people would come at me on this and say, you know, and I, you just disagree with me. I'm sorry. I've put plenty of text up on the screen tonight that you can read and see that it's what these people are saying. And I, if you hate, like, hacky politics, no matter where it's at in the political spectrum, then you should be super pissed about this stuff. You know, I'm out here because I believe in democracy, and I believe in community, and I believe that when we elect somebody to do a job, we wanted them to do that job until the end, and we eat whether they're bad at it or we as the voters come back and have an outcry. But if you go and look at photos from that particular hearing at our townhouse, you'd see police just lined up in the back. Let me see if I can actually pull that up really quick. Okay, so yeah, I'm just gonna, this is, so, and I do want to give full credit, okay? This is the photo that I'm about to show up was taken by Abby Hamilton from the Ledger transcript. So it's just, you know, I do want to give full attribution for all the work that we do, you know, you guys see up here. But, okay, so this, you got a wall of police officers sitting in the back, just like being a little imposing, honestly, about the whole situation. And look, I'm not gonna be particularly anti-cop, but I'm not gonna get too deep and personal on it. Like, I have my opinions about what a cop's job in our society should be. I don't have anything against, like, cops as people. I respect you professionally. But police have power that regular people don't. Like, if you don't think for a half a second that a cop doesn't know that they have serious power over you the moment they pull you over. Like, you know, like, right after I graduated high school, I actually got arrested. And the reason I got arrested was because I did not know my rights at the time. Like, I had many, many opportunities to push back, and I actually hadn't done anything particularly wrong at the time. And it was more like the police recognized me. Like, they had more or less profiled me because this is a small town, and, you know, they know kids get in trouble. So they I guess they recognized my car. They pulled me over, pressured me until I told them where my weed was. It happened. And, I mean, look, like, I'm a white guy. I am not even gonna, I'm not even gonna dig into all of the places that you can go and learn about police abuse of power, police brutality, all that, okay? Now, I think it's important that if you are a police officer, to remember at all times that, not that you really need to be reminded, but you got that power over people. And I think that's power hungry. And if you want to be the kind of cop that dispels that, then I would suggest don't stand in the back of a room like that and be intimidating. I would just highly encourage you not do that, because as somebody who's had both good and bad experiences with cops, like in my life, seeing that photo concerns me in the sense that there would be, I look, solidarity, whatever, but man, I don't want cops. I don't want like cops as a monolithic group to be deciding what happens to people in our communities. Okay. I will trust local police prosecutors. Okay. I had, I had interactions with Chief Jammarino when he was in charge over in Greenfield. And like, that was an example of a really, really great, police prosecutor. He did an awesome job, and he works with his community, and that's important. And I think that's the model when you're talking about small towns. But know the line, man. And that when you're getting into the county, that you're talking about something that's much bigger than that, especially one that's as heavily gerrymandered as this one. It's just that kind of thing matters a lot, frankly. And I'm personally really concerned about the signals that this gives, that it's okay for an appointed attorney general to come in and say basically, oh, we don't like the job you're doing, so whoop, we're gonna take you straight out of your position and just fill it in with somebody that we'd prefer. And I think for me, seeing the executive council reject David Mara is, and I don't know whether, I'm not saying anything good or bad about David Mara personally, although there's reasons to look into just his motivations and things. I mean, we pay that guy, I want to say, north of $200,000 a year out of taxes between what he makes now as his in his position as drug czar, plus his pension from being a former police chief, which he damn well earned. But at any rate, he's doing a job right now, and I think we should be getting the bang for our buck out of that one. And he shouldn't be taken off that to do a job that we of the county already voted somebody to do. And, you talk to police chiefs and they say, well, when Conlon took office and replaced Hogan, we thought it was going to be better. We're still having problems. Well, maybe it doesn't take overnight to fix something. Maybe we can't just snap our fingers and repair this office. But hey, what about Hogan, right? Well, the AG's office will say that they had, they had problems with Hogan. They also had certain things where they worked well together, but what was Hogan actually like? How bad was the AG's office before Conlon got there? What was happening? Because right now what we're criticizing Conlon about is not being aware of an assistant attorney who negotiated deals that were just way too lenient, and Conlon wasn't aware of it. It was basically like something slipped out from under him. He wasn't able to catch it all because, let's face it, at 3,000 cases in a year, that's a busy office. And they are incredibly understaffed. I don't have exact numbers on that here, so if I'm able to get them for folks, I will. But look, things are going to slip, and sometimes you're going to have results that not everybody's happy about, and we can nitpick over single cases here or there if we want to. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do that a little bit with Hogan, okay? And I just want to kind of compare bad on it. So let's see here. There was a lawsuit that I'm going to pop up on the screen right now. So this is a lawsuit filed by a former police officer named Lisa Sensabella. And just make sure I've got all my papers here. So in the text here, basically, Lisa Sensabella was a police officer with the Ware Police Department. And let's see here. I just want to make sure that I get all these names right. Kimberly McSweeney and Sergeant Kenneth Cox made several requests to Sensabella to file a complaint against their Lieutenant Michael Carney at the time. Now, Carney ended up leaving, and Sensabella sort of starts to wonder, hey, is there some sort of conspiracy going on between Cox and McSweeney? And also suspects that another officer, Sheila Severia, is involved in this. She's sort of being attacked by this, or just, you know, feeling incredibly uncomfortable, and ends up breaking down at the sight of Carney at a local bar because she seeing him made her, you know, be worried that they would be seen together, and she would be accused of conspiring with him against the officers who are currently still there. She's placed on administrative leave. Let's see here. I want to make sure that I have all of these events in direct lines, that I'm not super, super off point here, but, she leaves, she goes on medical leave, comes back, signs a second chance agreement with everything, saying not going to start problems or anything like that. So when she returns in May of 2015, it's just, quote, an onslaught of false allegations and internal affairs investigations against her. So she ultimately gets placed on administrative leave again. And files charges against the officers. She ends up getting fired on the grounds of an arrest without authorization, which she claims that her then Sergeant McSweeney had given her instructions to do this. So she says, well, I was given instructions. They said, no, you weren't. She gets fired for unlawfully arresting somebody. Ultimately, there were Freedom of Information Act requests about interactions between Hogan and McSweeney, and in particular cover-ups basically Hogan legally providing cover for McSweeney in a couple other situations. And Lisa Sensibilla's lawyer had filed Freedom of Information Act requests, which Hogan fought, saying he didn't need to provide them, basically stonewalling them on these documents that they really needed to prove their case, likely because they would incriminate Hogan's office and, you know, covering up crime, or at least, you know, hiding it. Covering up, hiding, same thing. So, downplaying, I guess. I don't know what kind of words you want to use for it, and I don't want to be too sensationalist here, but, like, ultimately, the lawyer who had filed the Freedom of Information Act requests was denied because he had filed for them and not the woman who had filed the complaint, Sensibilla. But they went back. He lost. Documents got turned over. They ended up ruling in favor of Lisa Sensibilla. So I don't know, man. What's worse? Covering up for cops that are attacking other cops for virtually no reason? Or not being so on point that you were 100% aware of what was happening with county attorneys that, like, assistant county attorneys that you've only been working with a few months, and you're not entirely familiar with every single case that they're working, and there's poor communication, and there's a lot of other problems surrounding it. Like, look, like, at the end of the day, Hogan caused actual problems, and, you know, withheld information, arguably broke laws. So if we're going to do an apples to apples comparison on what's worse, Conlon or Hogan, if it was this bad before, why did it all of a sudden happen that 3 months after you replace a conservative county attorney with a Democrat county attorney, that you all of a sudden get these, like, just angry calls to have him pulled back, you know? And you know, it just, you know, the Deputy Attorney General Jane Young has been pretty, you know, vicious about this whole thing too. And it's just the way they talk about these things, it's really hard to, that, you know, it's really hard to tell who's, if everybody's being honest about everything that's going on. It's the problem seems relatively opaque, but the problem seems relatively opaque, but, you know, at the end of the day, if there's one arm of government that touches our lives the most, it's the judicial branch. And when you talk about, particularly elected positions, but even appointed positions, that's oftentimes under-discussed, not paid enough attention to, and it's where a lot of the really nitpicky law stuff gets decided. You know, I mean, when you look at any sort of cultural precedent that we have set, a lot of times it's related to a court case. You know, the court case decides that that outcome. And oftentimes can be far more powerful than anything that Congress could put out there. It can happen much faster. It's controlled by, in a sense, a lesser number of people. I mean, it may be more in the whole when you look at the bureaucratic steps that things have to go do to make it to a Supreme Court. But ultimately, at every step of the way, it's a much smaller pool of people that are actually doing the assessment or passing judgment, as the case may be, framing the arguments on either side. You know, it's important to remember that, you know, for lawyers, it's not about telling the truth. It's about winning. And it's not about what happened. It's about what you can prove. And that's why so much political language, like those, the gymnastics surrounding that exists, is because it's a way to run around things and make it seem like you're answering a question when you're not. It's how, you know, just the way McDonald dodged that question from Andrew Valinsky. You know, we have tried to engage this county attorney constructively and collaboratively when asked, you know, are you saying you won't agree to a mediated process? Why you got to dodge that, man? And why didn't you do something like take over all of the caseload from Hogan? Why wait? Those are sort of my questions going out. And if I am able to talk to anybody else about this issue, if I'm able to go into it more and give more information, if I got anything wrong, I'm going to come back to it, because this is not something that's just going to end tomorrow. This is something that everybody can check back in on. And it's just, yeah, it matters. It really matters a lot. And this is, you know, it's our county. It's Hillsborough County, man. It's going to affect us, you know. God forbid something happens to anybody watching this, you know, that, like, and has to deal with that, you know. I feel bad for anybody who knows going into having to deal with the county attorney's office right now that they have a caseload that's four figures big. It's not a great look, and it's not a confidence booster in the sense that, I mean, that we feel like we're getting all of the time and attention that needs to be paid to things. And it sounds like, you know, that also needs to be worked out between, you know, and certainly as much as I say all of this, there absolutely needs to be improved communications between the county attorney's office and the local police departments. Okay. Like, it's annoying to have to read off very isolated quotations from people that really don't, you know, maybe it tells us how that person feels, but it gives us no frame of understanding what the conversation between the two people was actually like. You know, it's like, oh, well, this person's upset about what that person did. Okay. Well, what was the conversation like? How bad was it? You know, could you mediate it? Does it have to do with somebody maybe just not understanding what the other person is dealing with? I mean, that's where most understandings or misunderstandings typically come from, is just a lack of being able to put yourself in somebody else's shoes. So, I mean, at the end of the day, you got to imagine that there's a lot of private conversations happening behind the scenes where it really does come down to, like, how someone's personality plays against somebody else's. And, you know, I've heard him say it before, and maybe someday I'll be lucky enough to have Peter Leishman on so I can ask him about this. But, you know, he's talked a lot about how relationships are everything. And it's, if there's one thing that I've picked up from him and knowing representatives that have been out and working at the State House, it is really about like what you can convince somebody to do or not do, or, you know, how many people were out sick during a vote, or like, it's so, you know, there are so many things that play into why it is the way it is that I think we all as local people should just be, it need to be more aware of. And it's not even that it's our fault that we don't know, like it's not something that anyone would think to talk about. So I'll try and get a little bit more detailed on that stuff as I do more shows. And with that, I'm going to end the stream tonight. Thanks to anybody who checked it out. If nobody checked it out live, then that's cool. You can check it out later, because that's what's great about YouTube. Or the internet. Is that it's forever. Anyways, thanks for coming out, folks. You can, again, head down to the description where you can find our Facebook, Twitter, Patreon. You can help feed us. You can like our pages. You can follow us. You can give us comments and say how much you love or hate what we're doing. Any suggestions for events, stuff like that happening in the area, hit me up. You know, if you've got, you know, activism, anything like that going on, get it out here. Let's share it. Let's broadcast it. Hopefully I can have some people from some campaigns come on soon. I want to talk to them about what their experiences are like dealing with, building grassroots movements, what, you know, boots on the ground type of stuff. What are they encountering when they're out doing their canvassing? What are voters liking? What are they not liking? I'm hoping to have a conversation with at least a couple different campaign organizers. So that's something that I'd like to see happen in the future. And yeah. Thanks for coming out, everybody. And we'll catch you next week.